Braincast, der Schulfunk zum Gehirn.
Hallo und herzlich willkommen zum Braincast. Mein Name ist Steve Ayan, ich bin Redakteur bei Gehirn und Geist und ich bin hier in Jena am neuen Campus der Universität. In diesem Gebäude hinter mir, hinter dem Schrotthaufen, findet dieser Tage die TEAP statt, die 51. Tagung experimentell arbeitender Psychologen.
Und hallo Steve, was machst denn du hier?
Arvid, ich dachte, ich nehme dir vielleicht mal die Arbeit für einen Braincast ab und tu mich hier auf der TEAP ein bisschen um und frage Leute nach der experimentellen Psychologie dieser Tage.
Okay, dann erklär mir doch erstmal, was ist denn experimentelle Psychologie? Faltet man da das Sofa hoch, während die Leute dran sind und nimmt EEG und...
Ja, zum Beispiel, also schau, das ist der Tagungsband. Es gibt hier 550 Beiträge von Psychologen aus dem ganzen deutschsprachigen Raum zu so interessanten Themen wie zum Beispiel, ist Ekel eine Emotion? Wie fällen wir Entscheidungen? Worauf achten Fußballspieler beim Elfmeter? Es gibt Laborstudien, Feldexperimente, Volksstudien, alles, was das Herz begehrt. Ich würde sagen, wir tun uns mal ein bisschen um, oder?
Hast du auch noch Interviewpartner wenigstens?
Habe ich, ja, aber die kann ich dir jetzt noch nicht verraten.
Na gut, dann schauen wir mal, was passiert.
Auf geht's! Ja, wir sind ja hier in Jena auf der TEAP, auf der Tagung der experimentell arbeitenden Psychologen. Und die große Frage ist, was tun experimentell arbeitende Psychologen eigentlich und warum ist das wichtig? Ich habe hier einen Experten neben mir stehen, den Chris Frith. Das ist ein Professor für Neuropsychologie aus London vom University College. Und er hat sehr lange Erfahrung auf diesem Gebiet und ich werde ihm jetzt ein paar Fragen dazu stellen. Professor Frith, we're here on the TEAP, the Conference of Experimental Psychology in Jena, and my first question is, experimental psychology sounds maybe unfamiliar to many people. Basically, people have a lot of theories about psychological issues. We're all psychologists in a way. What is the difference between normal, like folk psychologists and experimental psychologists?
What experimental psychology does is to discover which bits of folk psychology are right and which bits of folk psychology are wrong. And there are all sorts of strange ideas that we have which turn out to be completely wrong. And there was a very interesting lecture last night from Mike Burton about face recognition. And what he was showing is that we're very, very good at recognizing familiar faces, but we're very, very bad at recognizing unfamiliar faces, which of course is what people at passport control do when they look at your passport and they look at you and they say, is this the picture and are you the same as the photograph? And he's done various experiments to show that actually people are very bad, even when they're confronted with the actual person in the photograph, of recognizing whether it's the same person or not. And this is an example of the kind of, which is very surprising because we all believe we're very good at that. That's because we're good at recognizing people we know. And how you recognize people you don't know is a different question altogether. So that's an example of the kind of thing experimental psychologists can investigate. And what he's developing is new ways, replacements for photographs, for example.
But of course, a lot of people are sort of skeptical about the thought that psychological issues like thoughts or feelings could be measured, which measuring things is a very important part of experiments. What would you answer to these people who say, well, how can you measure what I feel or how my thoughts are going?
There's in fact a sort of pecking order in science where you have the so-called hard sciences like physics at the top and the soft sciences like psychology at the bottom, precisely because physicists are measuring objective quantities like the speed of light. And psychologists are trying to measure subjective things like how happy I feel. And I think this is, in a sense, unfair. All of our lives depends on these subjective experiences and being able to talk to each other about what our experiences are. And in fact, we're, on the whole, quite good at this. And you can measure things like happiness by simply asking people to rate themselves on a scale from 1 to 10 or whatever it may be. And this works quite well. I had an interesting discussion with an eminent economist in the UK who is concerned with the recent discovery by economists that wealth doesn't make people happy. And therefore he wants to measure happiness directly. And he has this weird idea that the best way to do this is to put people inside a brain scanner and see which bits of the brain light up. And I was trying to persuade him that even if you did that, you would still have to ask the people whether they were happy or not to validate the results of this very expensive technique.
Yes, in fact, you've been one of the first to introduce techniques like neuroimaging into psychological settings, trying to get the connection between what happens in the brain during certain psychological states. Nowadays, there have been a lot of doubts coming up in different studies if these measurements are so good. And there was a recent study calling it voodoo correlations and hinting at some methodological problems connected with this. Do you see a sort of decline in the Eurofear concerning neuroimaging techniques in this? Do we have to be more skeptical about the measurements that these techniques deliver?
Yes, I think we were all aware of the problems with these techniques, and the paper you're talking about was actually criticizing one particular method, and there are other methods that people use to which these criticisms would not apply. But in general, the problem has been, really going back to what we were talking about just now, that when you show people pictures of brains with coloured blobs in them, particularly if they're not in the field, they think this is real objective evidence, whereas in fact it's a statistical picture you're looking at. And it's rather like my economist friend who thinks that he can get more out of brain scans than he can out of asking people what they feel like. So certainly there are areas like in use of brain scans in court cases or something like that where one thinks one has to be extremely careful. And from the point of view of a hardline experimental psychologist, which of course are the people at this conference, the brain imaging results are simply another measure like reaction time, which you can use to get more information about the sort of psychological states you're looking at. And as long as we treat it as just one of many methods and treat it with caution, I think it will continue to be used, and it's going to be even more widely used, certainly in the UK, and I think that's true here too. Every decent psychology department now has to have its own brain scanner.
My last question is, you've been here now since yesterday, and you've in your lecture yesterday you presented a lot of recent neuroscience studies, especially on the field you're concerned with, social cognitive neuroscience. Do you have a favorite experiment of yours, like a design that you really think beats all the others, or is very intriguing in a way?
I guess at the moment my favorite experiment is the one carried out in the psychology department of Newcastle University, where they have, as in many departments, a kitchen where people go and make themselves coffee, and the milk is supplied by the department, and people are supposed to put money into a box whenever they use some milk. And what typically happens is there's the money in the box never actually covers the cost of the milk. And the people there had this brilliant idea of an incredibly simple and well-controlled experiment where they put a photograph above the money box. And one week it would be a photograph of a pair of eyes, human eyes, and another week it would be flowers, and then the next week it would be eyes, and the next week it would be flowers. And what they show very beautifully is that when there are eyes, people put more money in the box, which is very interesting because this is completely irrational behavior, because there's no one is actually watching you. So this is an example of what we call social contagion, that we're all incredibly affected by social cues, and these alter our behavior in a striking manner, and we're often not aware of this happening.
Well, thank you very much, Professor Frith.
Ja, ja. Und dann können wir auch vielleicht schon um 10:30 Kontakt mit dir aufnehmen.